Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Salatu wassalamu ala asyrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin. Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillah, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this opportunity to continue our lesson in the commentary of Aqidah Sanusiyah. And we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this majlis a blessed one, where Allah open for us doors of understanding and bless us with forgiveness and answer our prayers, and bless us with iman and taqwa. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from all difficulties, trials and tribulations in dunya and akhirah. And bless us with husn al-khatima, and gather us with Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yawm al-qiyamah. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. In our last lesson, we were speaking about the attribute of as-sam'u wal-basar. And before that, we spoke about the attribute of al-haya. So we are still in the explanation of sifat al-ma'ani. And inshallah ta'ala, before we continue, I feel it is important that we do some revision, because there are a few things that we have to understand. And important for us to come to a good understanding, because there are certain things that will come which requires a foundation to understand those things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us in easiness. So basically, what we have covered is the attribute of al-qudra, al-irada, al-ilm, and then we entered into al-haya and sama' wal basar. And we mentioned that sama' wal basar, it is related to the mawjudat, the things that are of existence, that are in existence. And the things that are in existence are divided into two categories. Category number one, it is a wajib, and category number two, it is the jais. And the author gave us the example of what is wajib, that is, what is wujud, that is wajib, mawjud, that is wajib. And he gave the example of the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Clear, inshallah? Yani, the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or we say the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is wajibul wujud. The existence of the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wajib. Likewise, the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are also wajibul wujud. So as-sama' wal-basar, they are related to the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are related to the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has his entity, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has his attributes. He has his attributes, meaning they are related to the attributes. Likewise, pertaining to al-basar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his basar is related to his entity, and his basar is related to his attributes. Meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees his entity and sees the attributes. All these are coming. I'm just, doing some revision of the things that we cover. So point number one, when we speak about mawjud, we have wajibul wujud. So this is an example, the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second category is the jais. Jaisul wujud, or we say mumkinul wujud. And mumkinul wujud, yani the author mentioned there are how many categories before this? How many categories there are four categories. The fourth one there is khilaf. But the first three, number one, it is a mumkin that has been created last time. Number two, it is a mumkin that is occurring now. And number three, it is a mumkin that is going to be in existence in the future. And number four, it is the mumkin that will not be created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when it comes to the mumkin, and mumkin al-wujud, there are four categories. The last one, there are differences in amongst the ulama. That's what the author mentioned. But the prevailing judgment is that the mumkin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not any create in the future. We say this is any part, any of the mumkin, any that is related into the kudrah and irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ala kulli hal, these are some of the things that we mentioned. But what is important is all any of the mumkin, whether we speak about the first category, second category, third category, fourth category, they are linked any to the sama wal basar, only any pertaining to the mawjud, only any pertaining any to the mumkin, any that is in existence. So mumkin, any we have mumkin that is not in existence, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created any the mumkin last time, it is not in existence now. So this is not related any to sama and basar. Why? Because it is not in existence, although it is in existence last time. But now it is not in existence, so we say now it is not related to the sam' and basar. So when it comes to the mumkin, we are speaking any only mumkin that are in existence. The mumkin that are in existence, they are related only to the sam' and basar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what I'm saying basically, I'm just repeating the definition of sam' and basar. Sam' and basar, they are related only to the mawjudah. It is different only than al-ilm. Knowledge is greater than it was. Knowledge is greater than it to the mawjudat wal ma'lumat. Correct or not? It is greater than it to the things that are in existence and the things that are not in existence. The knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is greater to the wajib, is greater to the mustahil, and is greater to the jais. Whereas sama wal basar is only greater than it to the mawjud. So we have to get right in this difference between al-ilm and sama'in wal-basar. So we say as-sam wal-basar, it is more specific any than al-ilm. I mentioned that last week that the knowledge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything, whether it is something that is in existence or not in existence, whether it is wajib or mustahil or jais. So this encompassment of the knowledge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is an encompassment any that is general. Whereas as-sama wal basar, the encompassment, or we say the linkage of sama wal basar, it is related any only to the mawjud. It is not related any to the ma'lum. Yani we say that Allah, the hearing and the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are not related to things that are not in existence. They are only related to the things that are in existence. Meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears the existent beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees the existent beings. And we say Allah did not hear the non-existent beings. And if the being is non-existent, it has no relation with the sama of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has no relation with the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But different from knowledge. Although we say something that is not in existence, it is related to the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning Allah knew. So this is any difference between the attribute of knowledge and the attribute of sama al basar. But the similarity is that all these attributes, the attributes of knowledge, attribute of sama, attributes of basar, all of it is inkishaf. All of it, it is inkishaf, and it is encompassment. It is different from the attribute of qudrah and irada. The attribute of qudrah and irada is ta'thir, yani it gives effect. Qudrah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives effect based on his irada, on his will. Yani if you go back to the definition of qudrah, it says sifatun azaliyatun. It is sifat that is azali, yata'atta biha ijadu mumkinin wa idamuhu ala wafqil irada. Yani the qudrah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bringing the mumkin to existence or bringing from non-existence, from existence into non-existence. Yani either bringing it and from non-existence to existence, or bringing it and from non-existence from existence into non-existence. So when we speak about qudrah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, qudrah of Allah gives effect. Yani it brings something from non-existence into existence, and it brings something from existence into non-existence. And it has a relation with the irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani this relation of bringing non-existence to existence and existence to non-existence, it is based on the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we mentioned that qudrah and irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is attributes that give effect. Yani please write this down. Please write this. The attribute of qudrah and irada, these are attributes that gives effect. Inshallah, I will explain more inshallah. Just write this down. خلاص. The attribute and your kudu and irada are attributes any of ta'sir. You put in bracket ta'sir. T-A apostrophe S-I-R. Yani in Arabic it is ta, then hamza, ta, hamza, ta, then sa, ya, ra. Ta'sir. Ta'sir any meaning give effect. طيب, let me give you a simple example in Arabic language when I say give effect. طيب, now look at this cup. Yani I am moving any this cup meaning from here to here. This basically any meaning I give effect. Tamam. Yani I give effect any from my ability. I'm bringing any this cup from here to here. And this effect that I did yani with my ability, it has a relation with my will. Yani before I move any this cup from one place and to another place, beforehand I have will, correct or not? I have will that I need to move this and from here to there. And I move any this cup from here to there. So is that effect? The effect any there is a movement, correct? A movement any from one place to another place. This is a simple example I need to understand when we say that the attribute of power and will, these are the attributes any of effect. Point number one. طيب, now when you speak about the attribute of knowledge, knowledge is not the attribute of effect. Al-ilm is not any attribute of effect, but it is inkishaf. That's what we mentioned many a times. It is inkishaf, meaning, yani now we give a simple example. I know that this particular cup is at the edge any of this table. Yani based on knowledge, correct or not? طيب, does my knowledge has any effect on the cup? Again, I knew that this particular cup is at the edge of the table. Based on what? Based on knowledge. Does my knowledge any has any effect any on this cup? My knowledge any has no effect any on this cup. But my knowledge any in kishaf, yani it encompassed and it came any into an understanding that this particular cup is at this particular place. But it does not give any effect any to the cup. Different yani than my strength and ability. Earlier, I gave an example, I move this cup from here and here. And I knew, correct or not, based on my knowledge, that this cup, earlier it was at that particular place. Now it is in this place. Type, my knowledge has no effect on the cup, but it is my ability that gives effect, correct or not, based on my will, that gives effect on the cup, that it moves from that place to this place. But my knowledge encompasses everything. Encompasses this sequence of events. Meaning I knew any beforehand any that this particular cup any is initially any it was at the edge. And then any I move it any into this particular place. So here any we say my knowledge is in kishaf. Yani in kishaf any meaning it knew, it come any to an understanding. Likewise the attribute of basar and sama'. Likewise any attribute any of sight and hearing. Yani to give a simple example, I see any all of you any in front of me. Does any my sight any give any effect to any of you? No. Yani meaning any I saw you any in front of me, meaning I come any to understanding any that you are in existence any in front of me. I know any that this person any is on my right side, I know any this person any is what you call it in front of me and so on and so forth. So sight any is also in kishaf, like knowledge. Knowledge any is in kishaf. Likewise, any my sight any also in kishaf. My hearing any is also in kishaf. If someone is shouting any outside the masjid, I knew that someone any is outside. But does my hearing any give any effect? My hearing does not give any effect. But my hearing any informs me, in a sense, that someone any is outside. So it is in kishaf. So there is a difference any between the attributes any of ta'sir, as what I mentioned earlier, kudrah and irada, and the attributes of in kishaf. The attributes of inkishaf are three: knowledge, al-ilm, al-samu wal basar. Knowledge, sight, and hearing. Clear, inshallah. Inshallah, clear, inshallah. Knowledge. So, write this down, Ali. This The attributes any of ta'sir, earlier we mentioned how many are there? How many? Two. Qudra and irada. Write this down. Then we have the attributes any of inkishaf. How many? There are three. Al-ilm, al-samu, wal-basar. So write this down. Inkishaf. This is any very important. Yeah. We have to come into an understanding now before we go on. Otherwise, it's going to be tough to understand some of the things that the author is going to speak about. But I will see, inshallah. There are certain things in Aqidah that is difficult. It requires explanation and explanation. So I hope at least you understand 80% of what I said earlier. At least 80%. Not lesser than that, inshallah. Okay, inshallah. If not, then 100%. So this kind of knowledge and we need to study. Yeah? You cannot just read books. You cannot understand. We are in need and need to learn. This is the issue nowadays. Certain things in Islam, you are in need and need to study. Certain things, and you can read books and you can read about history, no problem. But there are certain things and that you got no choice in yet, except that then you have to learn them, and then you have to memorize. Then only we can come to an understanding. And all this requires any effort. Nothing any is easy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us in your tawfiq. So we have sifat ta'thir and sifat inkishaf. Now I go to inkishaf. Now we concentrate on inkishaf. I mentioned any there are three. Al-ilm, al-ilmu, was-sam'u, wal-basar. What is any difference between al-ilm and sam'u and basar? Al-ilm is more general, you say. It is related to the wajib, mustahil and jais. Meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knew what is wajib, He knew what is mustahil, and He knew what is jais. Yani, for example, He knew what is wajib. What is any day? Example, any of wajib? Wajib is the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani, we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew His zat. Allah knew His sifat. This is any thing, and we say knowledge of Allah is related to the wajibat. And we say knowledge of Allah is also related to the mustahilat, the thing any that is mustahil. For example, Allah mentioned in the Quran, لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهِ لَفَسَدَتَا. Allah said in the Quran, if there are two gods other than Allah, or gods other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what will happen to the heavens and the earth? There will be fasad. Everything and it will clash. Is this impossible or not impossible? This is impossible. Correct or not? Yani, other gods than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is it possible or impossible? Impossible. But Allah mentioned about this in the Quran. Yani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, if there are other gods other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will not see this universe run in perfection. Because there will be a clash of powers. But when you are able to understand that this universe run is managed with perfection, then you understand that there is only one God. The one God and then sustain any this universe. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His knowledge is on the mustahilat. Although any we say mustahil are things that cannot be in existence, but it is related to the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knew the mustahil. Clear, inshallah. Likewise, any we say Allah knew the wajib, Allah knew the mustahil, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew the jais. Any jais, any like all of us now. Yani we are jaisul wujud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew our essence and our attributes. Likewise, any those who existed before us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew. This is all pertaining to the knowledge. The relation of the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards the wajib, the mustahil, and the jais. But when it comes to the as-sama wal basar, they are only related to the mawjud. They are only related to the existent beings. And existent beings, in as I mentioned, how many? There are two types. We have the wajib and we have the jais. There is no mustahil. Yani when we say mawjud, it cannot any be from the mustahil, because mustahil cannot be in existence. So it can only be either from the wajib or from the jais. So this is where we say that the sama wal basar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are related to the wajib. They are related to the wajibul wujud, not wajib only, but wajibul wujud. Yani wajib that is in existence. That is the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the attributes of Allah. And it is related only to the ja'izul wujud that are in existence, like all of us now. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears us and He sees us. So from here, inshallah, we will continue. From where we start. So we will read anyway on page 93. Notice. Now this is a bit difficult, huh? So if you understand what I mentioned earlier, this one it should be no problem. So we have to pay attention a bit now.
Notice. Know that He, the Exalted, hears His hearing with His hearing.
Okay, wait first. Okay, now we go one by one. Now any the author any speaks any about Asam, the hearing any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears His hearing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears His hearing. Taib. Earlier yani I mentioned that Asam wal Basar, they are related to the Al Wujud, Al Mawjud. They are related only to the beings that are in existence. And the beings that are in existence, they are the wajib and jais. When it comes only to the wajib, the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here we say the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, attribute of al-hayat, attribute of al-sam'a, wal-basar, wal-kalam, al-ilm. So now, the attribute any of al-sam'a, we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears His essence and Allah hears His attributes. This is in the beginning, and when He say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears the attribute any of His hearing. So this is exactly what I mentioned earlier, only it is just an extension. Yani the author is trying to make us go into a deeper understanding about what He is speaking about. So when we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears His essence, likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears His attributes. From amongst any of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is His hearing, correct or not? And from the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is As-sam'a. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears His hearing. Meaning, yani this hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is related to all of His attributes. Because all of the attributes is wajibul wujud. They are in existence. Now, with His hearing,
with His hearing, and sees His sight with His sight.
Likewise, pertaining to the attribute of Al-Basar, yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees His sight with His sight. Meaning His sight is related to His attributes, that is Al-Basar. So here we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sees His attribute of seeing with His sight. Because any attributes and we say it is wajibul wujud. The existence and is wajib and it is related to sama wal basar. As what we mentioned for sama is the same any for basar. Now,
just as He knows His knowledge with His knowledge.
Now, just like He knows His knowledge with His knowledge. Yani His knowledge, it is related to the wajib, the mustahil and the jais. The attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is from any the wajib. So knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompass His knowledge, His attribute of knowledge, His attribute of sama, His attribute of basar. All any of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are known by the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Continue.
This is because the attributes of manifestation in kishaf.
Now he speaks about in kishaf, yani knowledge, sama, basar. That's what I mentioned earlier. These are the attributes of inkishaf, meaning they do not give any effect. It doesn't mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears Himself, meaning there is a change in Himself, but based on His hearing. This is not correct. Because when we say that the sama, wal basar, wal ilm, these are inkishaf, we are not saying that it is ta'sir. It gives any effect to the entity, or give any effect to the attributes. But it is just an encompassment. encompassment, like the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like what you call it, the as-sama' wal basar. So it is different yani than qudrah and irada. Because qudrah and irada yani gives an effect. But knowledge, as-sama' wal basar, it is encompassment and it is not about any giving effect. Because nothing any can give effect to the entity of Allah. Nothing any can give effect any to the attributes any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If something else can give effect to the entity any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is same as a hawadith. And this is impossible. So nothing any can give any effect to the entity any of Allah and the attributes any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is why when we say knowledge any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompass any his knowledge, his sama, his basar, it does not mean any that it gives effect, but it is just an encompassment. His knowledge encompass everything, including his entity and including any his attributes. Likewise, any his hearing encompass everything that is existence, including his entity and including his attributes. Likewise, any the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it encompass everything that is in existence, including any his entity and his attributes. So I hope any is clear, inshallah. Inshallah, if you have any question later, you can ask. We complete any this paragraph. This is because
the attributes of manifestation in Kishaf are linked to themselves.
Now, clear, inshallah. What is meaning any are linked to themselves? We say that knowledge any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is related any to his attributes. Yani knowledge any of Allah encompass the knowledge any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Correct or not? Because it's in Kishaf. This is an inkishaf. The hearing any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears any his entity. And this is a way of inkishaf, encompassment. So it is not a way of if giving effect. That's what we mentioned. Unlike
the efficient attributes.
Efficient attributes meaning, as what I mentioned earlier, the attributes that give effect. There are two attributes, al-qudrah wal irada. So take note any of this term. Take note of this term, maybe underline this and put down there qudrah and irada. These are different any from the attributes of inkishaf. These are the attributes any of ta'sir. Attributes any of ta'sir.
For they are only linked to contingencies.
What is they goes back to what? They are only linked to contingencies. Goes back into what? To what? Yes. So it's very important, understand any this pronoun here. They are only linked to contingency. They here goes back into qudrah and irada. So please write this down. Before any you forget, because sometimes you can forget. So you need to write this down. Because at home any if you revise, at least you can remember. These things any we have to write down, otherwise any we will forget. After 1 year, khalas, and you need to learn again. But if you write, inshallah, as one, there's an Arabic, and we have a saying, al-ilmu sayd wal kitaba tuqayr. Yani, knowledge yani, is like the animal that you hunt, and kitaba is qayr. Yani, you are able to catch. So knowledge, in order yani, to prevent us from forgetting, we have to write this down. So unlike the efficient attributes is qudrah and irada, for they are only linked to contingencies. Contingencies meaning the mumkinul wujud, mumkin. The things that are mumkin or jais, these are contingent. The qudrah and irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are only linked, as we mentioned last time, they are only linked to contingencies. Whereas knowledge is linked to what? Wajib, mustahil and jais. Sama wal basar, they are linked to the mawjud. So can you see this difference in the linkage? Qudra is linked only to the mumkin. Irada is only linked to the mumkin. Al-ilm is linked to the wajib, mustahil and mumkin. Sama and basar is linked to the mawjud. Please memorize this. And then last time we spoke about the linkage of Qudra. How many there are? There are two. We have suluhiyun qadim. And we have Tanjiziyun Hadith. This is a linkage for Qudra. For Irada also we have two. Suluhiyun Qadim and Tanjiziyun Qadim. For knowledge, we have only one. Tanjiziyun Qadim. For Sama and Basar, last week we spoke. How many linkage we have Sama and Basar? Yani we have three. pertaining any to the linkage on the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the attributes, it is tajiziyun qadim. And pertaining to the linkage any on the mumkinul wujud, is divided into two. We have suluhiyun qadim, before the creation of the mumkin, and tajiziyun hadis, after the creation of the mumkin. Clear, inshallah? So we have to memorize definition of all these attributes and the linkages. And we must be able to explain to people what is the meaning of suluhiyun qadim for qudra, tajiziyun hadis for qudra, suluhiyun qadim for irada, tajiziyun qadim for irada, tajiziyun qadim for ilm, and all the three for sama'in and basar. So by this, alhamdulillah, at least we have a minimum any understanding any of the knowledge any of sifat al-ma'ani. Otherwise, any without this knowledge, meaning we have not understood yet sifat al-ma'ani. So again, any I mentioned understanding sifat ma'ani, you have to understand definition, ta'rif, and ta'alluq. Yani both any you have to understand. And the difference any between any all these attributes. So now, inshallah, we continue. Now we enter into al-kalam, the attribute any of al-kalam. But before that, is there any questions any so far? Is there any questions any so far? Yes. Yeah. The question is asking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears his hearing. Allah hears his hearing. His hearing goes back any to his attribute of hearing. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Sami'. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala possess the attribute of hearing. So here any what he's saying is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he hears his attribute of hearing. Because any to understand this, if you go back any to the ta'alluq, to the linkage, we say that the hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is linked to the mawjud. And part of mawjud is wajibul wujud. That is the essence of Allah and the attributes of Allah. So that is why we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears his attributes. Just like any we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears his essence. But we cannot be imagining that Allah hears like how any we hears. We do not understand, correct, the reality of this hearing. But here we are speaking any about the link. How Allah hears any wallahu alam, we do not know. But we say that the hearing any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is linked with his attributes, meaning Allah hears himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears his essence and he hears his attributes. And from the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the attribute of hearing. So meaning he hears his attribute any of hearing. Likewise, and he sees his attribute any of sight. Because it encompasses. Meaning his hearing encompasses any his attributes any of hearing. And his sight any encompasses any his attribute any of seeing. Inshallah. Is there any other question? Yes.
You mentioned that for Allah, Sama and Basha is related to existent being.
Existent being.
So how does the Suluhiyun Qadim come into the picture?
Okay, good question. Now, this requires what you call it further, any explanation. Okay. The question that he is asking now when we go back to the linkage of Sama and Basar. I mentioned last week and also earlier, how many linkage we have for Sama and Basar? How many? Three, yeah? This also have to write down. Number one, linkage number one. Now I will explain again, no problem. Yani, we have a lot of time, no issue. Our class said we do not have like a deadline. So we can take our time. Now when we go back and need to speak any about the linkage of Sama and Basar. Everybody ready, inshallah? The linkage of Sama and Basar, and we say ta'alluq, the ta'alluq of Sama and Basar. Meaning what is it related to? The Sama and Basar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is it related to? So we say it is related, there are three types of relation. Number one, it is related to his essence and attributes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mawjud, correct? Allah is in existence, his attributes are also in existence. So there is a relation with his hearing and sight. So we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears his essence and attributes. Likewise, if we say Allah sees his essence and attributes. But what is this linkage? The linkage that is linked to the essence and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is tanjiziyun qadim. So this is point number one. We have to come into this understanding. Tanjiziyun qadim. I think by now you understood what is meaning of tanjiziyun qadim. Clear inshallah? Do I have any to explain what is tanjiziyun qadim? Qadim, yani as we mentioned, it is azali. Yani it has no beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears himself. This hearing, this link has no beginning. And he has been, what do you call it? Occurred, correct or not? Tanjizi. This is tanjizi. When we say that the essence of Allah is qadim, this ta'alluq is also qadim. And this occurrence and he is also qadim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears in himself that this hearing and he is qadim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees in himself that this sight and he is qadim. Correct or not? The relation and he is also qadim. So when it comes into the essence and attribution of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is tajiziyul qadim. This is point number one. Everybody clear inshallah? Before I move on, is there anybody who still does not understand what I'm saying? All understood inshallah. Now we go to the question earlier, and he asks, how is suluhiyun qadim when it comes to the sama and basar? Point number one, earlier I mentioned about essence and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is qadim. The relation is tajiziyun qadim. This is point number one. Now we speak any about the makhluk. Like all of us now, we are in existence. What is the ruling any of our existence? All of us are what? We are mumkinul wujud. Correct, huh? Or jaizul wujud. Are we wajibul wujud? We are not wajibul wujud. Allah is only wajibul wujud. We are mumkin al wujud. The sight and the hearing any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is related any to our existence. Correct, huh? Meaning now, we are in existence, Allah is hearing us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is hearing any our essence and hearing any our attributes. It is related to the hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah hears. What is any this relation any of the hearing any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and our existence now? This is tanjiziyun hadith. Not qadim. Why? Because we are hadith. Meaning in each and every moment, Allah sees us and hears us. In each and every moment. And this relation is tanjiziyun hadith. Clear inshallah? Tayyip. Before our existence, before Allah created us, the relation of the sight and the hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards any our existence is suluhiyun qadim. Before we are in existence. Meaning before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, the relation of the sight and the hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is suluhiyun qadim. What is the meaning of suluhiyun qadim? Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can hear us any if he wants. Yani meaning he can create us at any time and he can hear us at any time. But it's just that Allah has not created us and put us into existence. So this relation any of his hearing towards our existence is suluhiyun qadim. Clear inshallah? This is any the answer to your question. Because you asked any about suluhiyun qadim. So suluhiyun qadim many it is related any to what? To the mumkinun wujud that is going to be created. Clear inshallah? Because there's a difference between suluhi and tanjizi. What is the difference between suluhi and tanjizi? Tanjizi meaning it has occurred or occurring. Whereas suluhi, it has not occurred. But Allah is able to make it occur. Correct, no? It is within any ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is Is there any questions? Everything clear, inshallah? Yes. His hearing and our hearing. Our hearing is makhluk. Allah created our hearing. Yani how when we hear, we hear basically by our ears. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we cannot say that Allah has ears. Na'udzubillah min dhalik. We cannot yani imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the same as our hearing. Our hearing is a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the hearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is His attributes. It is not a makhluk, it is not creation. It is from the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's that? No effect. It is in kishaf, it encompass. Meaning when you are speaking, I hear what you are saying, correct or not? Does my hearing has any effect any on you? Does my hearing, yani when I'm speaking, for example, you hear my voice and you are able to understand what I'm saying. Does your hearing has any effect any on me? No. Your hearing encompass what I'm saying. Correct or not? It increases. Now we're speaking about human beings and our hearing. Later inshallah we speak about attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani to make things easy, now we look at our hearing. Look at it at our hearing. When you are speaking, I am able to hear what you are saying and I'm able to understand. I increase in understanding, correct or not, what you are saying. But if you are just keeping any quiet, and for example, if I look at you, I do not know anything, correct? I do not know anyone is saying anything that you want to say. But once you speak, then I'm able to understand. Does any my understanding has any effect on you? Or does any my hearing has any effect on you? We said there is no effect. But what is any the thing any about this hearing? This hearing it is, I am able to encompass any what you are saying. I am able to understand basically what you are trying to say. Correct, huh? But does my hearing has any effect on you? No effect. This is the meaning of inkishaf. Just like any, for example, my knowledge. I'm able to know that there are people behind them. Does my knowledge, based on there are people behind them, has any effect any on those people? No, it's just that I increase any in my understanding that there are people what you call it at the back. Correct, huh? So that is why we say knowledge, hearing, sight. Sight is also the same thing. I see the people around me. Does my sight have any effect on the people around me? No. My sight, what enables me to come into an understanding that there are people around me. But it does not give any effect to the people around me. What is the thing that can give effect to the people around me? If I do something, correct? If I do something. If I stand up and I push someone, for example, if I do something and then only you say there is effect, and this effect then it comes in from which attribute? It comes in from power, yeah, strength and ability, and this ability is based on will beforehand, meaning I will to change any something, then I do it with my strength. So we say these are the attributes of ta'sir, whereas my knowledge is in kishaf. It increases any in me understanding. Of course, we are saying any human beings, Allah is different. But this is just to understand about so many of these attributes. What does it mean when we say it is in kishab or it is taqsir? Do I understand, answer your question? Is there any other questions? No question? You also have to look at the time. How many minutes have passed? Because we cannot speak too long. Otherwise, it's going to be difficult to digest. Now, when we have a bit of time left, we'll continue to the next paragraph. Now, when we will enter into the attribute of Al-Kalam. This is a bit challenging now to understand Al-Kalam. So, before we start, just my advice. If you come today, because today we cannot cover any Al-Kalam. If you come today, I will advise that you come next week. And also the next coming week, because I think next week also we might not be able to cover Al-Kalam. Wallahu a'lam, maybe. Because Al-Kalam, you are in it, you need to study and learn. Because if you come today, I'm just afraid any the meaning and you'll be hanging. So in order for us to come to a good understanding, we have to be consistent. This is just my advice. But of course, any no force. Even if you cannot come and you can listen any to some recordings. But what is important any is that when we study some of these things, it has to, you see, in every knowledge any that you learn. And this is something any that is important. Whether you are learning fiqh or you are learning aqidah or you learning tasawuf, you must cover the whole kitab, the whole book. Yani from the beginning and to the end, because all these books and they are written in a way where the topics and they are what you call it explained in sequence, and they are related to one another. So if you are learning any a particular kitab, a particular book, then for us and to come into a good understanding in our subject, we have to complete the kitab. So we cannot be learning any halfway, because otherwise knowledge also becomes any halfway. So some any doubts any cannot be answered. But once any we cover, inshallah all doubts any can be answered. Because I know some of you maybe have some difficulty to understand certain things, and then sometimes also you do not know any what to ask. Correct? But you must be patient. Inshallah ta'ala, if you are able to cover everything, then inshallah you are able to see the whole picture. Because now we are just halfway through the kitab, so sometimes we are in need of patience. Ala kulli hal, now when we enter into the attribute of al-kalam, which is translated as speech. Now, bismillah.
Speech. Kalam is a meaning that subsists within the divine entity and manifests in diverse expressions.
Right, now this is what you call it. Part any of the definition any of al-kalam. So basically any the author any saying that the kalam any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is a sifa. Yani it is an attribute any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that subsists within the entity. Just like any when we speak any about ilm, sama, basar, al-hayah, kudra, irada. We say all these are attributes that subsist within the entity any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all any of the attributes any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are qadim. None of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is hadith. All the attributes any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is azaliyah or qadim. And then he mentioned and manifests in diverse expression. Tayyib. Last time in Kharida Bahiyya, when we speak any about the meaning any of al-kalam, we differentiate between kalam nafsi and kalam lafzi. Kalam nafsi and kalam lafzi. Yani, to give a simple example, now we go back any to ourselves. We go back to ourselves, any for us to understand. Any for the sake of those who does not follow Kharida Bahiyya, Last time we mentioned, we have kalam is divided into two parts. This is Arabic language, kalam in the Arabic language. Now we shift us from the definition of aqidah, of kalam in aqidah. We speak about the language first, Arabic language, because it has a significance. In the Arabic language, when you say kalam, there are two types of kalam. Number one, we have kalam nafsi. Number two, we have kalam lafzi. Kalam lafzi comes any from lafz in Arabic, any meaning utterance. Like now I'm speaking, this is kalam lafzi. Now I'm speaking, you are hearing my voice. This is lafzi, and it comes from lafz. Like in Malay also we say lafaz, and it comes in from the word lafz, meaning utterance. This is kalam lafzi. There is another type of kalam that is called kalam nafsi. Meaning, now, if I keep quiet now, you are looking at me, for example. I am quiet, but inside me I'm speaking. Correct or not? All of us are speaking. Like all of you now, all of you are quiet. But in your hands, you are saying something. Correct? Some of you might say, the subject is difficult. Some of you are saying, after this, anywhere can I go? Or what do I eat ready for dinner? Correct? Or some of you are saying, for example, plan. Tomorrow morning, what you call it, I must go out any early. Because I have an appointment. And you might be saying in yourself, these thoughts that you have in yourself, you also call kalam. But this is kalam nafsi. Clear, inshallah? In the definition of kalam in aqidah, we are not concerned about kalam lafzi. We are concerned about kalam nafsi. This is the thing. This is the thing that we have to understand very, very well. That is why in the definition that I gave in Kharida Bahia, a simpler definition. Here the definition is a bit lengthy. But it is the same meaning. But I feel that the definition in Kharida is simpler. It is sifatun azaliyatun nafsiyatun. The definition says sifatun azaliyatun nafsiyatun. Laisat bi harfin wala sawt. It is kalam nafsi that is not comprised of letters and sound. Tadullu ala jami'il ma'lumat. That it explains any every known thing. So the kalam in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say it is kalam nafsi. This is qadim. Kalam in nafsi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is qadim. But this kalam in nafsi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani, is manifested in many times. The kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, kalam nafsi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is manifested in writing. Where? In Lawhul Mahfuz. Lawhul Mahfuz, yani, what is in Lawhul Mahfuz? In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the Quran initially was from Lawhul Mahfuz. And if you study about Nuzulul Quran, that's what Allah mentioned in the Quran, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. We sent the Quran in the night of laylatil qadr. You read any the tafsir, the mufassirin, and what do they say? They say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran from Lawhul Mahfuz to Sama'ud Dunya. So what is the meaning? The Quran is sent from Lawhul Mahfuz to Sama'ud Dunya. Yani Lawhul Mahfuz, the Quran is in the form of what? Writing. Meaning kalam nafsi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is manifested in the form of writing. In Lawhul Mahfuz. That is why we have Allahu wal Qalam. Allahu wal Qalam. And we have the pen and the tablet. So the Al-Quran al-Karim, that is the Kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is Kalam nafsi. But when it is manifested in the form of writing, this writing is not any the Kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the Kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is nafsi. But we say it is manifested in the form of writing. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran to Jibril alayhi salam in the form of meaning and also recitation. So now in the kalam and nafsi, it is manifested in the form of writing, and also it is manifested in the form of recitation. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Jibril alayhi salam, it is the recitation with the meanings. And Jibreel alayhi salam, and he sent it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's how we got our Al-Quran al-Kareem. But when we say Al-Quran is kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the kalam that is qadim, what is any the kalam that is meant? It is the kalam nafsi and not kalam nafzi. It is not any the letters and sound, but it is the meaning behind those letters and sound. This is any the meaning of kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes into the Quran. So it is an attribute that subsists within the entity of Allah, and it is nafsi and it is qadim. Whereas letters and sounds, it is makhluk. Correct or not? It is hadith. So when we say that Al-Quran is kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we say Al-Quran and it is qadim, meaning what? Meaning, the meanings that be behind any of those letters and sounds is qadim. Clear inshallah? And those meanings any are manifested any in the form of writings and sounds. That's how any we get our writing and also the recitation. So Allah Alam, any now, any time any is up, I cannot explain any further more. But this is just any to give you any a gist of what any we are going any to speak in detail inshallah next week. Because any if you look any what the author any is saying, you can get the picture and what he's getting into. And he's going and need to go into detail. So that is why I hope all of you can come next week. Clear inshallah? Because what I explain now is not enough. I'm just speaking any about part any of the definition. Part of the definition. Inshallah, next week, it'll be more clearer inshallah. And if you have any question, inshallah, we can wait any for next week. But for now, based on what I mentioned earlier, if you have a question, you can ask. For now. Is there any questions so far? He said, manifest in diverse expression. Sorry, before we stop, let me give you a simple example. Some of you, I think, might not understand what I'm saying just now. Let me give you a simple example and related to us, ourselves. Now, I have some thoughts in my mind now. There are a few ways that I can express my thoughts, correct or not? I have some thoughts in me. And I want to express it. What are the ways that I can express my thoughts? Either I write, meaning I write on the whiteboard, for example. For example, I have some thought, for example, that I want to go to a certain place after class. I can inform you in a few ways. Either I say it out, I say inshallah ta'ala after this class, I'm going to this particular place. Right, you understand. Now the kalam nafsi is translated to what? Kalam nafsi. Correct or not? So initially it's kalam nafsi in my thoughts. Then I express it in the form of utterance. Or I write it down. I say after this class, I'm going into this particular place. Now it is also an expression. But it is a different type of expression. It is not by lafzi, but it is by kitab. It is by writing. And I can also express using hand signals. Yani without writing and without speaking. And if you understand any hand signal, and I can just do some hand signal that I'm going into this particular place. So in order for me to translate my kalam nafsi, there are a few ways. Right? Either I by writing, by speaking, or by hand signal. Now, if we have the kalam nafsi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, when it comes into Allah, we cannot be imagining like our kalam nafsi. When we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala possesses the attribute of kalam, here it meant kalam nafsi, not kalam nafsi. There is no kalam nafsi attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because kalam nafsi is hadith. Whenever something is uttered, it has a beginning. And this is impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not associate kalam nafsi to Allah. Yani we cannot be saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks like us with letters and sound. This is mustahil. This is the aqidah of the mujassima. The mujassima, they are the ones who associate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah created his own sound, speaking like us. This is impossible. So we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks. How does Allah speak? Yani kalam nafsi is manifested in the form of writing in Lawhul Mahfuz. This pertaining to the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran from Lawhul Mahfuz to Sama'ul Dunya. And gave it to Jibreel alayhi salam. Taught Jibreel alayhi salam its recitation. So Jibreel alayhi salam recited to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Clear, inshallah. And this is going to speak mention anybody the author, inshallah, pertaining to Jibril alayhi salam, anyhow, what you call the Quran, and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inshallah, yani we will speak next week, inshallah. If there is no question, I will end in my class, inshallah. إلى حركة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الفاتحة.